You let Zach get under your skin.
Little shit, sure did. No, but,
damn it! We're not recording yet. Oh shit, we're recording.
No,
wait, it's over.
I like quick, the fact let's that you said "damn it," which we can do, and then you back it up with a word that we can't use.
Exact job.
Hey, whatever.
All right, let's go.
Let's do this.
Your show, your rules, right?
That's like freaking damn out right. When you run over a dog.
Except
and
when
you run
Google
over
overrides
paper.
It.
Exactly. And Google's fine with it as long as I don't put a little not explicit check.
Running out of, running over your dog, realizing what you've done, backing up and running over the dog again.
that's a problem.
Well, vet bills are expensive. Vet bills are expensive.
Yeah, they are expensive.
Okay. You guys ready?
Hey, I got
an email. I was born ready.
We're going to start.
All right.
On this episode of the Culture Smash Cast,
spiders like poop.
Christopher Nolan gets elitist again.
And the Ouija board says yes to the box office. All this plus Zach plays some kind of obscure video game.
It's not really obscure.
Shit Jesus is the new pizza joint down the street.
I want some.
It's delicious.
Can I get extra Jesus?
That's better than where I was going.
It's obscure.
It's not triple.
If you're playing it, it's obscure. Let me show you the flow chart.
Let me just bring that volume down real quick so we can start the next segment.
The chart says...
We need like a whiteboard back there so we can draw Venn diagrams.
With that is that'd the best idea cool. We've ever had. We could probably just put one on the back of this painting and just flip
that
it around.
That would be awesome. Maybe we could get one if we could just slip inside the frame because it's got a little ridge there.
That'd be cool. Because that's hung pretty solid, isn't it?
It's don't you remember when we hung that, it actually went through the wall.
Yeah, that's what
hallway.
I was thinking.
Yeah.
It's a 2-inch nail.
Through the hall?
Yeah, we punched holes in the hall. They had to patch it and repaint. The maintenance cost.
Wow.
That picture is hung.
That damn thing is
my eye!
I can see how this show is going to go. All
right, we should do more comedy.
I agree. We're pretty damn funny.
Really, I think the whole thing is a joke.
We're funny until we try to be.
Yeah, that's fine. Well,
let me stop the recording.
There's something to be said for that.
I thought I could wedge it in there, but I was wrong.
Oh, sorry.
So I'm going to try one more time and start recording. Here we go.
So we're done cussing now?
We're done cussing.
Okay.
So Culture Smash Cast, episode 339 for November the 4th, 2014. I'm Stephen Lackey, editor of CultureSmash.tv. Send to the right of me.
Nicholas Qualls, contributor to CultureSmash.tv.
And to the right of him.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dwayne Pate, and I'm a contributor at CultureSmash.tv.
On the left of me.
Mike Young, contributor to CultureSmash.com.
I know.
CultureSmash.tv.
Wow.
What threw me off is because you got the date wrong, and it's been... That's just...
Bug, what did you see the date? I usually noticed that, and I didn't pick it up.
This is...
It's the 5th.
It's the 5th. Oh, okay. Whatever. Hey, you blame it on me, Daniel. Don't you blame me.
This is
I
not...
I won't have it.
Wait, does it make it... So it's Guy Fawkes Day, right?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
You're supposed to remember this day.
Come on, Stephen. You had one rule all year.
I had one rule.
It's the only time we don't really celebrate. People celebrate something that didn't happen.
We celebrate a lot of things that didn't happen.
I feel like Columbus Day might fall squarely under that.
Columbus did come to the New World. That did technically happen.
It did happen.
But does anybody really celebrate that anymore? It's become like an anti-holiday.
People don't work on that day, and those people celebrate.
They celebrate for sure. It's true.
I think we need to turn it into Leif Erikson Day and make it.
I would be okay. I think it should be celebrating the Vikings.
I love how everybody's washing over Zach's intro.
Why is it?
Go ahead.
I am Zach Martin, contributor to CultureSmash.tv.
And supporter of Leif Erikson Day.
It's true.
Anybody remember that SpongeBob episode?
No,
I don't remember.
Happy Leif Erikson Day.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I remember. He's the guy who lives in a pineapple under the sea, right?
Yes.
That's him, yeah.
You know, like, they found evidence that, like, the Eastern Islanders actually...
Had pineapple houses?
Yeah, had pineapple houses.
I would love
to know where this is going, but I'm too busy.
There's like, genetic evidence that they...
They're related to Vikings?
No, but they made it to South America. There was like, a... What was it? I can't remember if there's like genetic evidence between the people or no. It was they brought like potatoes and stuff like that back and with them back to Easter Island. So I can't remember if that doesn't predate Leif Erikson, though, I don't think.
What are we talking about?
All right. It's the first story. That's why we don't do comedy.
That's why we don't let you talk. There's a difference.
It's soon about to start over again.
All right.
Erase my
Zach's got the first story?
So Zach does have the first story because Catherine's not with us because she's hung in CMA traffic hell.
So, where there's poop, there's flies. Where That's there's true. Flies, there's spiders. But what if there... Oh my gosh.
You cannot read.
You want me to do this?
But what if there's a lot of flies?
I was going to say...
Like a sewage treatment plant? Then this could happen. Insert picture here. This is a photo of...
Yeah, we had the picture in our rundown, but here it is for all you video watchers.
This photo is a section of a 4-acre web that was found in 2009 at the Baltimore Wastewater Treatment Plant in Maryland. According to this source, who ran these photos last week, an estimated 107...
You mean Wired? It says the source in the name?
Yeah. I didn't know if we could or not.
Holy crap.
Yes!
So, according to Wired...
It's kind of like you're supposed to, just so you know, Mr... You know, you're supposed to quote your sources, just saying.
So, who ran these photos last week? An estimated 107 million orb-weaving spiders of different species assembled a mega-web inside one of the plant's buildings. If you're afraid of spiders, then this web was something out of a nightmare. But a team of scientists who studied the web found it fascinating. In fact, they published a paper about the web. Quote, "We are unprepared for the sheer scale of the spider population and the extraordinary masses of both three-dimensional and sheet-like webbing that blanketed much of the facility's cavernous interior. Far greater in magnitude than any previously recorded aggregation of orb weavers, the visual impact of the spectacle was nothing less than astonishing. In places where..."
It's disgusting.
Yeah, I agree. "In places where the plant workers had swept aside the webbing to access equipment, the silk lay piled on the floor like rope-like clumps, as thick as a fire hose."
It's just like the Mega Web name. No. It's like, by your powers combined, I am Mega Web.
It's wild.
The mightiest of all webs.
There's no other webs.
It's like different species of spiders. It's like they had like a call to truce.
Exactly. They had like their own government.
Yeah, it's like, you know, we'll call a truce for this.
Well, this one says it's all orb-weaving spiders.
Oh my gosh.
Oh no, it says different species.
If you're a video viewer, you can see the picture. It's ridiculous.
Orb-weaving spiders was a species of spider.
Is it?
I don't know.
I think it's a type of spider.
Maybe.
I don't think all spiders weave webs.
Well, yeah, but... never mind. But yeah, that's pretty that is impressive.
It's pretty amazing. I won't lie, I would like to see it, but...
it's amazing.
Yeah, that's pretty good. This is why we don't do comedy.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, I get it.
Spider-Man.
Spider-Man.
Not quite a go-homer.
Yeah. Speaking of Spider-Man, did you guys see the 75 years of Marvel comics documentary?
You know,
it's on Hulu. I didn't watch it. Talk about it.
It was pretty good for us comic book people. There really wasn't anything.
I'm really excited.
Spectacular that we didn't know already.
Spectacular.
There you go.
The first issue of the actual Spider-Verse proper story arc in Amazing Spider-Man was
sweet,
today.
Right?
Yeah, so it's basically like. It's been happening for the last couple of months anyway, but this is the first time that Peter Parker is actually involved. Well, the proper Peter Parker.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited to pick that up when I get a chance to go to the comic shop.
So the documentary spends most of its time in the 60s.
That makes sense. It's the Marvel age.
But they really gloss over the 80s and 90s, especially the 90s. I would have found interesting.
Glossed over the 90s.
Well, yeah, but there's a lot that happens during the...
Yeah.
A lot of...
Well, and then they really gloss over the fact that the company nearly went under. They mention it.
That's one of the reasons I would have glossed over the 90s.
They do mention it, but yeah, it's a very...
Kind of surprised they actually mentioned that.
Would it have been nice to buy a little Marvel stock back then?
Oh, don't even tell me. Yeah, it would be ridiculous. But anyway, it was pretty good. It was worth seeing. We have...
Box office
this week. Let's take a look at what made money and what didn't. It's a little depressing looking at these numbers, I'm just going to say, when you see the number one movie. Number 10 was Dracula Untold. It made $2.9 million. That one's on $52.8 million so far on a $70 million budget. Number 9 is The Judge. It made $3.3 million. I mean, 39.5 so far on a $50 million budget.
I missed my cue on Dracula Untold because I wanted to mention something that I heard and did not realize this. So apparently this is supposed to be a reboot for the Universal Studio Monsters.
Is it really?
Yeah,
yes. Well,
the next one they're doing.
This movie looks horrible.
No, the next one they're confirmed doing is Frankenstein.
Yeah, I knew they were going to do that. I didn't know there was a connection.
We're going to get Abbott and Costello and Frankenstein of it.
That would be awesome.
Which is weird, though, because they just did a Wolfman movie, and it did not go over well.
And it wasn't that good, because it was kind of terrible.
Will Frankenstein star Robert De Niro again? Because I think that would be fantastic.
That would be kind of fantastic.
Yeah, see, that's kind of what I thought we were getting from the 90s, early 90s, was a reboot of all those franchises.
Well, that's what he was just saying, that they tried with Wolfman, or the...
Yeah, they tried with Wolfman a couple years ago. It bombed with Benicio del Toro and Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah. Well, I was even thinking, like, we had Dracula and Frankenstein and even Wolf with Jack Nicholson.
I think those were... I don't know if they were all under the same...
I don't think they were.
Yeah, production company. I think Universal is actually probably trying to do this. I think it'll be interesting. I don't think it'll make money, but it'll
they
be cool to see.
They trying to do these things, because what was that movie, that horrible Hugh Jackman movie? He was kind of like a monster hunter.
Oh, Van Helsing. Van Helsing was
a movie that
fine, but it wasn't good. It was
bad.
I enjoyed watching it. It had entertainment value, but it was not a good movie. I kind of wish there were more like really bad B-level like movies like that from
you. Well, like that you could watch that in Underworld and.
It was that kind of ilk. It was very much kind of like that whole. This isn't a good quality film, but it's got supernatural vampires and people killing things, and it's kind of fun.
The best thing about Van Helsing, though, was I was going to sneak preview of something else, and they had those Van Helsing posters were in the theaters. And in this area, there's a group of little old white-haired ladies that go to every sneak preview. They get tickets from one place or another. They're always there. Well, I'm in line, and they're they gotta be in their mid-60s, and this little tiny little white-haired lady looks over at the Hugh Jackman poster, the Van Helsing poster. She looked it up and down, and she went, "Hugh Jackman, yummy!" Like,
oh, come on now.
That experience better than the actual movie because it cracked me up. All right,
we're number 8.
My number 8 is Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day. It made $6.5 million. It's $53.7 million that one's made on a $28 million budget.
Pretty good day.
Mediocre day. Yeah. Number 7 is St. Vincent. Made $7.2 million. That one's made $19 million so far, and the budget has not been announced. This is that Bill Murray, like a little indie-looking movie.
I honestly don't even know if I've seen anything about this one. You know, Bill Murray, the entertainment... Weekly Magazine did like a quote-unquote reunion special, and basically what happened is they had like photo shoots of like various things, and they had a Ghostbusters photo shoot, and Bill Murray was there with Ernie Hudson and Dan Aykroyd and Sigourney Weaver, and I was like,
of course they do this after Harold Ramis.
Yeah, it's sad that they did, which might be one of the things that spurred it along, because that's the thing I always got from Bill Murray, is he was very standoffish on doing more Ghostbusters things, but possibly because of the passing of Harold Ramis kind of like shocked some empathy into him. I like Bill Murray.
Made him have a soul.
I think he had a soul. I just think he was kind of dark. I don't know. I like Bill Murray, and I was glad
to see Bill Murray.
They did that. There was some like, it was Mean Girls 1 and a Sports Night. I didn't really care about, but
a Sports Night.
I like Sports Night, but it was weird. Like, I was like, it had the two main stars of Sports Night throwing around a football, which is like really cool.
Okay.
I like the show, but
I never watched it.
It was early Aaron Sorkin television. You can tell because the first season they put in a laugh track. Which does not work for Aaron Sorkin television.
I'm betting Aaron Sorkin did not request.
No, you could tell because they started using it less and less and less, and it was gone by second season. All
right. So number 6 is John Wick. That one made $7.9 million.
I feel a story coming.
It's made $27.5 million so far on. We don't know the budget there yet. So I did, as I said, I was going to do Saturday. I went and saw Bat and Equalizer back to back.
Okay.
Screwed the man. Only paid for one, John Wick, which I feel very happy about. because
that's the one that deserves your money.
It deserves your money. Yeah.
Did you buy concessions?
I did.
You are supporting him.
That's right. I supported the man in a mediocre way.
The only one you did not support was Denzel Washington. Apparently.
That's true. The movie was all right. Yeah, I would have been just happy to see it on TV.
Okay. Yeah. Have y'all heard where they put all the clips of him saying guarantee together and move from all his movies?
No.
Hilarious. It's long. there must be a rule that he has to say the word guarantee in every movie.
I love it.
Because it is, oh, I guarantee it. Over and over and over. It's crazy.
So to
that can work on that for us.
Okay.
To all the right. John Wick thing, though, it was funny because we've been talking about this for a while because it's gotten pretty high ratings and it didn't seem like it should have.
Yeah.
Well, guess what? It's pretty damn great.
All right.
You know, there are a few scenes where, you know, Keanu Reeves does his traditional wooden sort of dialogue delivery, but it's kind of like he's getting to play himself, so it kind of works. It's kind of it's like how he was good in Speed, but he's kind of being himself. It's kind of like an older version of himself in this movie, and it worked for him. And
I don't think it's a canonical scene with Speed.
Yeah, I like that.
Okay. See, that's why I felt like Walking Club.
I like how serious you're trying not to laugh.
I was forced into that movie by a girl I kind of liked at the time. We had a group, like, you know, church youth group, we'd go see movies, and that was her choice. And I was like, yeah, and then I complained about it.
I would have too.
For a very long time.
This one is pretty super violent. The action is great. The second, like, tier cast is better than you expect it to be. The story is basic. It's kind of like nowhere near as good, but in a way, kind of like Payback.
Mm.
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't want to say why he, you know, because in the trailers you'd see, you know, I'm back.
Don't be a Zach, Steven.
He's back in the business. Well, the reason is very Payback-ish.
Kind of Parker-esque.
It is Parker-esque, yeah. So you should see it. It's good. The only thing, there's a lot of bloodletting, but there should be, as much as there should be more, because there's a lot of times where they do the gun kata thing. You know, the equilibrium?
Yeah.
You know, where they're like, you know, fist fighting and shooting at the same time. And he literally shoots some guys, like, point blank in the face. Now, they do pop a pretty big blood hole in their head, but, I mean, seriously, that head should probably be
gone, yeah.
As close as that gun was. But it's almost cartoony
what
in a way.
What caliber?
I don't remember. I'll let you watch it and tell me. But
I'll be like, no, that's completely beside from that distance specifically.
There's no chance. But it was fun. I hope it makes enough money. I mean, because this is a movie people should take the time and see because it's entertaining.
See, Steven, I appreciate the fact that you like movies that are just fun.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it's okay just to go and have fun.
Yeah. You know, sometimes I feel like someone's talking to me.
Do you hear someone talking?
Do you hear somebody talking to you, Zach?
I don't know. I feel like something's referencing.
Yeah. Sometimes it's
like
no.
Everybody's talking at you. You can hear a word they're saying.
Let me be clear. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking about you.
he actually avoids talking to you.
It's
kind
of true. He does. Yeah.
So remember the episode where I wouldn't talk to him at all? We should get back to that.
All right. So number five was The Book of Life. It made another $8.2 million. That one's done $40.4 million on a $50 million budget. You liked that one.
I liked it. And it's pretty close to making back its money. So
it is.
Well,
it looks very clever. If I had to choose between that and the Box Trolls, I would go for
it. I would recommend it. I haven't seen the Box Trolls, but
the previews for the Box Troll looked amazing.
The more that came out about it, the less interesting.
Once it came out, you didn't hear
it. It was like oversaturized to me. It's like I saw the previews way too many times. I just didn't care. Like the actual clay animation looks really good.
It does.
But I didn't care about the story.
Yeah, it's so weird because you think that would have just, you know, grabbed us. But somehow it just sort of fizzled. All right, so number four is Gone Girl. It made $8.4 million. That one's done $136 million so far on a $61 million budget.
That's amazing.
And it's 5 weeks in, so stop counting it. It's on Ball of Fools. Number three is Fury. That one made $8.8 million. $60 million so far on a $68 million budget. Not doing that great. Number two is Nightcrawler. It made $10.4 million for its opening weekend. It's last weekend. No what? Budget for that one.
I want to see that movie the more I see the
trailer. I almost really screwed them in and slipped into it after the Equalizer. If the art crawl hadn't been happening here in the city, I would have done it. And the number one movie over the weekend was Ouija.
Why?
Made another $10.7 million.
It was Halloween.
Wait, what?
Yeah, but it's bad, though.
It was still Halloween, weekend.
It was Halloween.
It came out, yeah, it was Friday was Halloween.
Yeah.
Okay.
34 points.
If it's number one again next week, and I think
it's probably not going to happen. Probably not going to happen. But $34.8 million so far on a $5 million budget, so who's laughing about this, really? The studios. That's who's laughing.
The movies that will probably be one and two, respectively, in some order next weekend.
Are opening Interstellar and Big Hero 8. Now, the funny part about this is Interstellar, at the time of this writing, of this script, which was last night, the Rotten Tomatoes rating was at 76%, which is a little painfully low.
I am surprised by this. Not meeting your expectations.
Right. And as some of the other critics that I follow and tend to like respect are giving it that same 7.5 kind of area. Big Hero 8 is apparently the better bet at 88%. And it looks cute.
That's better than Big Hero 6, I believe.
It is.
Which is the name of the film, right?
It is.
Big Hero 6.
Yes.
Somebody jumped ahead to the sequel.
Somebody's requesting.
Yes.
Very much. I can't remember what. I can't think of what adjective to use there. Then we get to the film ball stuff.
Oh, are they? Yes. Are they?
Well,
okay.
Unfortunately.
Strenuously.
Unfortunately, film ball has been moved.
Can you get your words out?
Work. Apparently, this is just a bad
thing. Yeah, okay. I was doing the same
Interstellar,
thing.
Interstellar, if we're lucky enough to hear, if you saw it on 35mm, 70mm, I'm going to see it 3 days early. So, in our city.
You saw it early. Okay, got it.
Just get it out.
The IMAX 70mm opened up early, and I saw the first showing last night.
And you have a review coming on Friday.
I have a review coming on Friday.
Yeah, Friday morning, 7 a.m. You can see our advanced review of the movie.
All right, I've got two questions for you. How much did you pay for the IMAX ticket?
$20.
Was it worth it?
The IMAX presentation or the movie?
Well, that's
the whole part together.
It's all together.
Was the experience worth it?
I don't want to go see 2 hours of senior porn just because it's in really great IMAX.
Okay,
so.
The IMAX presentation, if you're talking, there's an hour of
he's still not listening.
The sound is nuts.
Listen.
Was
the overall film going experience good?
This is taking a lot of effort.
Yeah.
This sounds like a no.
This sounds like a no.
It's a no.
I'm
going to
say
no.
I'm just going to be like...
It's a yes or no question.
Tell them. Why is this difficult for you?
Maybe.
Did you or did you not have sex with that woman?
We're all...
What's
sexual relationship?
Even Clinton could answer that faster than you've answered.
Exactly. It's true.
It depends on how we define the word.
How about this? If we're judging the film based on the first and second act, I'd say yes.
Okay. We define the movie as a movie.
I think I'm paying for the whole thing, though.
Yeah, we're not allowed to pay for a part of it.
Can I just see the first?
You just
see the first. All right,
I'm gonna bring
hours.
Go to the box office, give them $13.
I'm leaving it. I should get some money back from Transformers because I left 20 minutes early.
Yeah, would you like to know my overall score? Can we say that?
You can say your score.
My score would be 6.5 out of 10.
Zach's gonna talk more.
Yeah, here we go. We're gonna do a film ball.
Okay, good. There's a reprieve.
We got a break from Zach for a few minutes.
Whew.
All right, so for film ball, my phone just got a text. So somebody is desperate for film ball to happen. So here are the numbers so far. If you are unfamiliar with film ball, we haven't recapped the rules. Basically. Blocks, we each get 100 virtual bucks and bid on the movies that we think are going to make the most box office. And then we talk trash about that until it's over. And then we start over again for no really reason other than to talk trash to each other. So here are the numbers so far. For the contributor bracket one, which is me and Nathan and Dwayne here, and two listeners, Michelle and Bill, I am currently at I'm like, let me bring the volume up so that Nathan can talk, because I know he's going to want to. All right, I'll be fair. I'll mute you. All right, so here are my numbers. I'm at 126.7 million so far. Bill is at 289.5 million.
We you cheated.
Damn it. And then we've got Michelle, who is at 142.8 million, and Nathan, who is at $0 million. No money for Nathan. $0.
Go bite yourself.
Nathan is at 145.9 million.
Which is good position, seeing how I still have Interstellar and Dumb and Dumber 2.
He's in second place.
That puts you at second place right now, right behind Bill. So you said you have what left? Whoa, your camera went black on me.
Right about where it runs into James Bond.
Can anyone hear me?
I hear you. Your camera just went black on me. But that's okay. Now, there you are.
I'm back.
Shit. I didn't know.
All right, I'll run down there. So there's a part of the universe where I'm there.
Look at the smirk on your face. Well, I'm going to kick you square in the nuts when I see you. Turn the camera off. I can't look at you. Okay, so here.
That's okay. My nuts haven't been played with in a while, so.
Yes.
Any playing with them will make them happy.
A kick, a play, a tug, a tinch.
Alright, so we've got the contributor bracket 2, which is Catherine, Zach, Nico, and somebody else was in your bracket. I can't remember who it is. It's not just the 3 of you.
Yeah, there were more people.
There's one other.
I don't remember.
Sorry, sounds good. Thank you.
I haven't listened to your game yet, but the only people who have money right now currently are Zach and Nico. Woo-hoo. Catherine will change that this weekend because she has Interstellar.
How'd you get my list?
Hmm?
How'd you get my list?
I had it. Okay. Yours I had.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Let's see. So
I don't remember what I had.
Zach, I'll have to tell you. Zach is at 496 million, though, so that's all.
Oh, yeah.
Yep, and
I think there's a problem with the math somewhere.
Yeah, well, he owns everything.
I own everything until this weekend.
He owned the entire month of October, because when I saw that number, I was like, what? And I went back and looked, and it's like every movie in October, just about. And then Nico's at 121 million. Nobody else has money yet in that bracket. And then we have the listener bracket. And that one, okay, Hector, there was a glitch in your numbers. I fixed it. You are now at 418 million. Yeah. Zach still owns the game so far, though.
Owning it.
And then behind you is Tina, and she's at 173 million. Then Mike is 132 million. And Ada has no money yet because all of her bidding is on Hunger Games. She had nothing but Hunger Games. What do you got to say about that? Okay, if you see the video, there's a look on her face right now. I don't know why she...
Did you ask me what I have to say about that?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I have to say that at least this movie is not going to get pushback.
Well, we can only hope.
No, don't even go there.
I'm fairly sure the Hunger Games...
Fingers crossed and toes crossed.
That don't get pushed.
Every other part of my anatomy I can cross.
I'm fairly sure.
I'll put it to you this way. I definitely won't come in last, but knowing the amount of movies Hector has, and he's already at 400 million,
yeah,
I'm definitely not coming in first.
It's pretty ridiculous, because I don't know that the Hunger Games can do 400 million in 4 weeks.
Oh, yeah. Can Interstellar do that?
No.
No. Interstellar's not.
Looks like somebody might be doing good.
Shut up, Zach.
That was anticlimactic. Somebody.
Listen, my speaking skills tonight are just...
No, you're both.
How is that most? No, I think it's slightly worse than most nights.
Did it? Well, he had half of one beer, and that's...
No, it's not.
Yeah.
I doubt it.
Lightweight. Well, it's either half... You're either a lightweight and it's half one beer, or you're just stupid. Now, which would you rather be? Your pick.
Moving on.
Stupid. Okay. So that's the film ball numbers so far. It's like progressing. We are starting November. It's the last 2 months of the game.
Yeah.
This is actually the last month of Contributor 2 and Listener. So we'll know shortly who's going to win those games. I'm kind of excited for this spring bracket. There's a lot of interesting movies coming up after Christmas. So it should be a fun bidding.
Yeah.
So, wait, does Zach have to read again?
I have to read again. We could swap it.
That was busted.
So, wait, you want to do it, Nico?
So, Arthur C. Clarke's 1968 novel, 2001 A Space Odyssey, was adapted into a classic film by Stanley Kubrick. The second novel, 2010, Odyssey 2, became a cinematic footnote with 1984's 2010, The Year We Made Contact. Now, the final part of Clarke's Odyssey trilogy, 3001, The Final Odyssey, will be hitting the screen, but not for theaters. Sci-Fi has announced they've teamed with Ridley Scott's Scott Free Productions to adapt the final book in Clarke's sci-fi series, which begins with the discovery of Frank Poole's frozen body floating in space. From there, the story, quote, offers an extraordinary range of complex characters with conflicting agendas, stunning visuals, and dark thematic meditations on the final fate of all humankind. Stuart Beatty from Collateral will write and executive produce the miniseries. And while Sci-Fi gets a lot of attention for their campy fare, like Sharknado, they do occasionally go for the heavier series. And we've talked about them getting a 12-month series before in the past.
And there was a whole story that we did before that was all about them trying to get back to the sci-fi roots.
So I'm excited.
Gonna be some cool
stuff. I wonder how much it's going to try to more so connect to the movies or to the... Just go straight.
Well, if they're doing a mini series, if they follow suit, it's gonna stick to the books. Because if you look at the Dune mini series they did, those stuck to the books.
I think you're probably right.
Hoping that's what the. Now I haven't read the book. It may.
I haven't either. I've never read.
I don't know if I've read the
first one. How have you?
I haven't read either any of the.
You've read everything.
Yeah, pretty much. But it's been so long.
Dang.
Yeah, I know that was a serious pop on my neck.
Yeah, a serious popping. So I don't know. I'm excited, and I like this mini-series format idea too. I just think it's cool.
I do too. I think it works pretty well.
Although, that's what happened with Battlestar Galactica. Is they did a mini-series first, and then the TV series came after.
I don't think they're gonna make a series of 2001 though.
I hope not. I just hope they focus on telling us something really cool. And it's a TV story, but that was one of the things they talked about during the Marvel. Special last night was Agent Carter, and they showed some extended footage from there. I'm happy that it's only 10 episodes. I thought they were doing a series. They're calling it a 10-episode event.
No, I saw that too, and I'm glad that they're doing that too.
I don't see her first season.
Because that will get old at some point. You know how it's going to end with the creation of S.H.I.E.L.D. I think that lends itself better for a miniseries than what they're building. I saw the clip, though, the one where they introduced Jarvis.
Yeah,
the actual human Jarvis.
Yeah, did you see the Howard Stark his scene? That's what they showed last night.
They put that clip online.
It was pretty great.
I think sci-fi elements and action elements like that do work sometimes better in a miniseries because they can be one and done or ten.
Well, they've experimented with this thing before, where you'd have a regular full series that takes that break a month and a half, 2 months break, and they would wedge something else in there. Like, there was a show called Daybreak that nobody watched that I liked, and it was a 10-episode just in there, and it was one of those, it was a cop story, but it was set over 12 hours, and it was just 12.
Well, I think it also allows, in the Agent Carter S.H.I.E.L.D. case, to expand the world more so than you could inside the show itself.
Yeah.
For instance... Burn Notice when it was on the air. One season between the break, there was a movie on the Sam Axe character, Bruce Campbell's character. It was all prequel to the series, and that eventually had elements that were incorporated into the show. Mm-hmm. But, it built upon this fan favorite character in a way the show really couldn't dedicate the time to.
It would be neat to see stuff in the Agent Carter miniseries have some impact on future seasons of Agent Carter.
I think we'll get that, and they have the stuff in Agent. So in the first episode of S.H.I.E.L.D., the first episode of the second season, opens with Agent Carter and the Howling Commandos.
Does it really?
Yes, it does. And it's got the Howling Commandos. It's basically everybody that was in Cap except for Cap and Tommy Lee Jones.
That's kind of awesome.
And apparently, I think either there was another clip in a recent episode or there will be another one that has another flashback with Agent Carter. So they're definitely trying to tie it into it because they got to promote the Agent Carter miniseries.
Okay, fine. I guess I'm gonna have to catch up on S.H.I.E.L.D.
S.H.I.E.L.D. has been good this season.
I'm gonna have to look at it.
You can pretty much. I would watch the last few episodes of last season.
I kept hoping they would do one of those things, a little 45-minute recap.
Yeah.
Things that they would do. Yeah. All right. Cool. Well, we got more sci-fi on sci-fi, so that's a good thing.
That's a good thing.
The story was actually in the wrong spot, but I don't care. It's a cool story.
All right.
Who's got the next one?
Mike, thanks mostly to Marvel Studios. And I'm sitting here trying to think of ways to say, oh, no, they were doing that before. But no, really, it is. I mean, those post-credit scenes
existed,
but it's really Marvel's the one that makes you sit there and wait, expecting to see something now.
Totally.
And you know, my favorite, prior to Marvel, my favorite post-credit scene was Ferris Bueller.
Yeah.
You're still here? Go home.
Yeah, that is probably like the seminal one. It's even all the Marvel ones are as good as they are. It's hard to top the Ferris Bueller one.
Yeah.
Because it is, the whole movie is him talking to you.
And yeah.
It's very much to the point, it's like, come on guys, the story's over. Let's go. It's still keeping it raw.
And he just walks away and goes back in the bathroom. And this is great. All right, continue.
The like I said, they become somewhat of a staple for superhero movies, especially, and summer blockbusters in general. But if you're wondering why there wasn't a tag in 2013's Man of Steel, that decision came down to one man. Maybe not Man of the Hour, Christopher Nolan.
It's like not the Man of Steel.
Yeah. The while speaking with The Guardian about Interstellar, Nolan, who serves as executive producer on Zack Snyder's Superman movie, revealed that he personally nixed the idea when the studio floated it by him. And this is a lovely quote from our beloved Nolan. A real movie wouldn't do that.
Oh, he's so douchey.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, spoiler alert. There's no post-credit sequence in Interstellar. I checked.
Of course, you know, most of us would disagree with that strenuously, but either way, it'll be interesting to see if 2016's Batman versus Superman: Dawn of Justice follows suit.
Follows stupid.
Yeah.
Which I mean, that's quite possible.
Quite possible.
I don't get the objection. It's like I understand if you don't want to do it, don't do it. But
I think sometimes Christopher Nolan is just trying to be a douchebag.
Yeah.
Because to me, the post-credit sequence is brilliant as far as filmmaking goes because it actually.
It's an epilogue.
It makes people stick around and see the credits and see the people, see the names go by of the people who made that
Which
movie.
Is ultimately, it's like I'm one of 100 animators on this project in one of the three companies that did it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, my name, no one's going to pay attention to my name. But hey, they might actually see it because there's a post-credit scene.
Right, and you know, even if 10 people out of 10,000 see it, that's 10 people that wouldn't have seen it.
Yeah.
You know, so I think it is a cool
watching,
but it's also
I love watching the new credits, especially the blocks of like animated and CG people and whatnot, because some of them will have like great nicknames. Like there was like one that was like I think it was
they did that Pixar.
There was one in Captain America, the first Avenger. It was like Steve Super Mario Marriott, and that was the name. And I'm like, that is awesome.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Or seeing your relatives, and it's like, I didn't know they were in the movie industry.
Yeah, and why aren't they hooking me up for the job?
I will say an article about this story has come out saying that he was, quote, misquoted.
He always says he was misquoted. This comes from Mr., you know, Zach would probably marry Christopher Nolan.
I don't know, after Interstellar, I don't know.
Yeah, whatever, Fairweather fan.
You know what, Quentin Tarantino has a better track record than me, so I'd probably go to him first.
Fairweather. Oh, I don't know.
But then again, Warner has pushed the IMAX
David Fincher.
Format. David Fincher's an also.
Oh my God.
Yeah. That's just, yeah.
I wouldn't even have Nolan in consideration after Dark Knight Rises.
Exactly. He would totally be out. He wouldn't just be out of the bed. He would be out of the bedroom. It'd be over.
It's okay. You can come to my bed. I'll keep it warm.
Okay.
Wait. Yeah.
All right, Zach.
I'll be back when y'all clean up the podcast.
Zach, you have the next story.
So filmmaker Rob Zombie revealed this weekend that he is moving forward with his next project, a Halloween horror film simply titled 31. How original.
No, it's 3i, I think, isn't it?
It's 3i?
Is it?
31.
I was confused by the picture. What does it say? The text is 31?
No. It may be a typo, because in the end of the first graph, it's actually 3i. But the next line, where it's credits the Hollywood Reporter, says Zombie's 31.
Well, that was a cut. That's not me. That's a cut and paste from Hollywood Reporter.
Okay. So the Hollywood Reporter reports that Zombie's 31 will be take place.
See, you know what fixes that those issues, Zach?
Will be take place.
You know what fixes those issues? Checking your story in advance.
Will take place on Halloween and focus and follow five carnival workers who are kidnapped in the days leading up to the holiday and held captive in a kill-or-be-killed place known as Murder World. There they must fight to survive 12 hours of hellish game called 31, where a group of psychopaths dress up as clowns known as the Heads and hunt down the kidnapped carnies. How is this any different from, like, Battle Royale or The Hunger Games?
Okay, here's what I thought that was funny about that. There's a lot of people who are going to sit here and say that that is a sucky plot, stupid or whatever. But if it was animated and everybody looked like it was like done in anime style, people would love it.
I'm not on the Rob Zombie
I'm not on the bandwagon. I love Devil's Rejects. That's his best movie.
I will agree with that. What was it?
House of Thousand Corpses.
I didn't like that. I hated that movie.
I didn't hate because it had some funny parts in it, but it was just a little. He wanted to do too many things in one movie and it didn't work.
No, I agree. I also hated his. I did not like his Halloween.
I liked the first one.
I thought it ruined aspects of Michael Myers that I like in the original Halloween.
Well, I don't disagree with that, but I could sort of consider him. You know, it's kind of like. You know, alternate universe type of thing.
I considered alternate universe, and like, this is a crappy alternate universe to the superior Halloween.
I don't know. I didn't like it nearly as good as the first Halloween, but I enjoyed it. But really, House of Thousand or
Devil's Rejects was the best movie. I agree with that. I do not argue with that one.
Yeah, and I saw the other one, the Salem thing, the about the witches. Lords of Salem.
Yeah.
It's a pretty terrible movie, but visually, it's really cool to look at. Story-wise, it's almost like you just want to turn the volume down and watch it and put on
it's got a decent visual
an old thing. White Zombie album.
So it's an hour and a half long music video?
Yeah, kind of, okay. Which was sort of the problem that was with his first movie, with House of a Thousand Corpses. But this one, Lords of Salem, is even more so. Really great to look at. But story is kind of stupid. So he's another one that I think should direct somebody else's script. Let somebody else write something for him.
It was suspected that 31 might be a prequel in the House of a Thousand Corpses, Devil's Rejects, Firefly series. Is that what it's technically labeled as?
There was a mother Firefly in the first movie.
I don't know.
Yeah, there was some kind of Firefly.
It was her name. It was, yeah.
But Zombie plans for it to be the first installment of an entirely new franchise. We can't just have any one-offs anymore, ladies and gentlemen. It always has to be franchise.
That's right.
Production is scheduled to begin this coming February.
I don't know. I'll probably see it. I see all of his movies, and then I only, like, really love one. But I still see him.
Like I said,
he does R-rated horror, which is not a common thing, so I always give it a go.
Who was he? Because he lent his voice in Guardians of the Galaxy. Who was
he? Who did? Who, I was going to ask you that.
This is going to be a quick check, because I honestly have no idea.
Yeah, we were talking about who would it have been? Rob Zombie did a voice in Guardians of the Galaxy. Who?
You got to be Glenn Close's voice?
Glenn Close's voice? Yeah, maybe he was doing her lines. That's pretty funny.
Oh, God.
So let me take
Ravager a voice. Ravager Navigator voice. He was the voice of either he was the voice of a navigator on the Ravagers, which was Yondu's group, or he was like a computer voice.
Either way, he sounds to me like he's just friends with James Gunn and wanted to do something cool.
Yeah, that's okay.
I'm good with that, too.
I would play that
I
card.
Would do it, too. It's kind of like when...
if I was friends with James Gunn, I was like, hey.
You need more of that voice.
Yeah.
Alright, so are we moving to TV? Is that what's happening now?
And TV, with more comic stuff, of course. For those of you angry about too many Batman villains in Fox's Gotham, this might not help. Scarecrow is repeatedly in the works to appear in the series.
Reported?
Did I say repeatedly?
Yeah.
I have a cough drop in my mouth, by the way, so I don't just break out into a crazy fit. I went through almost a full bag of cough drops at work. It does not help working in a call center.
No, I'm the
rest of us going to crazy fits.
I'm constantly in a crazy fit. I just don't want to cough.
It's true. He comes in here.
So it's kind of like the Hulk. You're just angry all the time.
Yes. It's my secret cat. During Gotham's panel at Stan Lee's Kamikaze, according to Zap2it, Producer Danny Cannon dropped the news that he and the writing staff are crafting an episode that focuses on Scarecrow. Quote, on Gotham, the villain will be seen as a child before he takes on the Scarecrow moniker. In fact, it's something that will be passed on to him from his father. Which will create an eventual enemy for Batman while still having a possible adversary for Jim Gordon. A well-known entry in Batman's Rogues Gallery, the Scarecrow is well-known to fans for appearing in the animated series, and often prompting, actually, the I Am the Night line. I love that the episode where Scarecrow first shows up when he's, at the end, Batman's, like, hanging from a blimp, and he's, like, singing that, like, face of his father, saying, like, you failed!
Yeah.
You're a bad son! That's where he goes, I am vengeance, I am the night, I am Batman. It also says in the opening, too. But for comic fans, Scarecrow played a surprisingly key role in the Blackest Night event a couple years ago as well. So, but yeah, basically, I'm agreeing with the opening premise of this title. Too many Batman villains.
Yeah.
It's just, I got the concept, but I got instantly turned off on it when they threw them all in the first episode.
Yeah, and you can't have that many Batman villains when Batman is still a kid. I mean, they're all about his same age.
I don't know. I would say Penguin's a fair bit older, so I would say the age dynamic that they have currently is fine.
Well, what do you think? You're still watching it, right?
No, I haven't seen anything past the first episode.
Yeah.
It's not because I actually do want to see more of it. I just haven't had a chance.
I've been watching
it. And it's honestly less because of Batman. It's less because of that side of things. I was more intrigued by the actual procedural aspects.
Mm-hmm.
By the guy from the OC who plays Gordon, Donald Logue playing Bullock, like their dynamic together, working in this seedy, like corrupt city. I'm more interested in that. I'm less interested
in
Batman.
Well, it took a few episodes for it to actually settle into that, but it's gotten to be more interesting, although there is this sort of serialized element, but it's not focused on the evolution of Batman now. It's more focused, really it's focused on the evolution of the Penguin.
Yeah, I've noticed that.
Because that character is great. That guy is weird and creepy and fun, you know?
So I really like that part. It's going to be about Gotham and Jim Gordon. It needs to be about that, not Batman.
Yeah, it's true. Superhero-wise, The Flash is still the best show on TV.
The Flash
is great.
I love The Flash. It's so... I also really love Arrow, but The Flash has that light, kind of joyful excitement that Arrow just can't have because of how grimdark they built the show to be.
Yeah.
I think they balance each other out pretty well, so that's why I still both enjoy it.
And you have little crossovers, like the last week's episode.
Yep, Felicity Spoke was in the Flash episode. That was a cute episode.
It was a cute episode, yeah.
I love how they worked in Captain Cold. I love how they're doing all the Flash villains. Like, Captain Cold was a great addition into the series, how they're building the Rogues Gallery.
Well, I keep getting thrown off by the Captain Cold guy. Because he was on Prison Break.
Yeah, I know, right?
And I kept thinking, did you finally broke out and this is what you're going to do? Really? This is how you choose your life after you break out of prison?
He was really good in the role.
He was pretty intimidating, creepy,
Well, I guess spoilers, he kind of wins.
He kind of does, yeah. But that one's good. Other than that, are you watching...
I'm behind on everything that's not Arrow and Flash.
Are you watching American Horror Story at all this season?
No. I'm taking next week off for work, though, and that's going to be my television catch-up.
Awesome. Because American Horror Story has been great. Super creepy. And Walking Dead's been pretty entertaining. I mean, they really just said, hell with it. Let's go over the top with this thing.
I have actually been watching Walking Dead.
Okay.
Like, I saw the Beth and the hospital episode.
Okay. That one's going to be fun. But, like, the cannibal thing was kind of hilarious.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. It was pretty funny.
Promise.
That's right. Man made your promise. Right. And, you know, they slipped that one past me, too, because I actually forgot about that.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he did it, I was like, yeah, finally, this is like Return of the Jedi season for Rick. He's finally a man again. All right. What's next?
Next is...
I don't want to read again.
I'll read.
Why'd you get all the stories to Catherine?
Well, the problem is there are stories for Catherine and for you.
Yeah.
CBS is committing to a pilot for a limitless TV series based on the 2011 film with Bradley Cooper, Guardians of the Galaxy, Roberto Orci, and the amazing Spider-Man 2, Alex Kurtzman from Star Trek Into the Darkness, and Todd Phillips from The Hangover.
Now, that's like one actor and everybody else are writers and producers.
Mm-hmm.
The Deadline reports that the Limitless pilot is coming from another writer, executive producer, Craig Sweeney, the 4400.
And which was a show I liked quite a bit.
Me too.
And it's set to continue from where the movie left off. The film's director, Berger, has reportedly been tapped to direct the pilot, while producers Leslie Dixon and Scott Kropp will also work on the project. The pilot is based on the 2011 movie, originally, which was based on a book that was written by Alan Glenn. The story follows Brian Sinclair, played by Cooper in the film, as he discovers the power of the mysterious drug NZT and is coerced into using his newfound drug-enhanced abilities for good. Coerced into doing good.
That's a little bit questionable.
The Limitless television project is the first venture from Cooper and Phillips' newly formed production company, yet to be named company. I like that. I like that.
I actually like that name, too.
The first feature film, American Sniper, which also stars Cooper, is slated for release this Christmas. Have you guys seen the trailer for that?
No, I haven't looked at it.
It's intense.
Okay. All right.
I like Bradley Cooper. I liked him as he was a good, funny lead man. And then once I saw Silver Lion playbook, I was like, this guy can act.
Yeah, well, what did I saw him in something else.
He was also in Beyond the Pines, which is a little bit different character.
What did I see?
I meant to see that, but I missed it.
That, he was amazing in that as well.
I meant to see that theaters, but I missed it.
Talking about the American Sniper trailer?
Yes.
Holy crap, that was impressive.
What did I see?
They're able to make this super tense situation within like the span of like 45 seconds.
It's getting around me.
Oh, crap!
Yeah,
I gotta see this movie.
Admittedly, I was a little bit emotionally vulnerable when I watched it, but I was kind of.
You were emotionally vulnerable.
Wow. Yeah, which there's not many moments on that.
I was gonna say that's like every day, right?
Yeah.
I wanted to look at Bradley Cooper on IMDb real quick because there was something I saw from him that really did impress me, but I can't remember what it was.
Oh, I know. It was American Hustle, right?
No.
Yeah. It was The Hangover Part 3.
Yeah, no. You know what I think? The only thing I'm thinking of is Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
Hey, he was, I mean...
Rocket Raccoon?
Yeah.
The best thing he did in that movie was make me not think, oh, well, that's Bradley Cooper.
If I didn't know it was Bradley Cooper, I probably wouldn't have picked it out.
Yeah, same with me.
No.
I don't know if that was... If he does a really good voice or if they modulated the voice at all, mm-hmm. but it doesn't sound like Bradley Cooper.
I think it may be a little bit of both, but I think... Even it didn't have his cadence, you know, it didn't have, I mean, it was Rocky Raccoon, it wasn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
It wasn't the guy from The Hangover, or...
So what do we think about this Limitless TV series?
I don't know if she saw the movie.
Oh, did you? I thought you liked it. There was somebody...
I didn't like it, I just never saw it.
I remember you liking it.
I liked it. Yeah, I did like it. I don't know.
I think it's in my Netflix Insta-queue, which is never.
You should watch it. It's actually really good, but I don't know that it holds up for a TV series. It seems like a stretch.
Yeah, hearing that, I'm like, I don't see the point.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Is it kind of like, you know, going to be like a Knight Rider, except for Knight Rider's in his brain?
Oh, speaking of cars, there's car porn in John Wick.
Ah, cool.
He gets mad and just drives the hell out of a Mustang for a little bit.
Cool.
Yeah, and are you caught up on Blacklist?
No, I'm a few episodes behind, but again, next week catch up.
Yeah, because what's funny about Blacklist is Joel Gretsch is in this past week's Blacklist, who was the main guy of 4400.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so it just struck me like, oh, yeah, I just saw that.
You know what was really weird? The character actor, I forget his name, but the guy who plays Berlin in Blacklist.
Yeah.
He was in one of the episodes of Arrow, like the second episode of Arrow of this season. And I'm like, you're currently filming another show right now. They're on this. He wasn't like, it was a one and done villain, so it wasn't like a lot of time. It was so weird. It's like, but I just saw you in that other thing that's on my queue.
It just occurred to me that Dwayne went out.
Yeah.
So I should probably take a look. You keep talking. Let me make sure he doesn't just need
to. That's pretty much it. But I liked him on both. I need to catch up on a lot of television. I plan on doing that next week. That's one of the reasons I just have a random week off.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, what's on new on Blu-ray?
Well, you got it right here. Let's see what we got. New on Blu-ray this week is Maleficent. Then we've got Planes, Fire, and Rescue. The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, Extended Edition and 3D Editions. Then we've got Hercules, 2D and 3D Editions. And An American Werewolf in London, a Limited Edition.
Ooh, there's a
steelbook,
actually.
Is it a steelbook?
Oh, really?
Oh, that's cool. Why do I like the steelbooks?
They're special. Like, how often can you say, I got a steelbook?
That's kind of cool.
And the packaging is always cool. It's not just a stupid-looking, like, Photoshop cover. It's
actually
handcrafted artwork, which is what everyone likes and prefers over Photoshop.
What killed me, though, is I got the steelbook for Robocop.
Yep.
And then they put out a 4K.
Here's what you do.
You buy the 4K.
You buy the 4K.
Stick the disc in the steelbook.
And you put
the
steelbook.
That's probably what I
I'm just trying to think of, would there be much improvement on a 4K Robocop?
Well, yes. Yeah.
There would be. If you look at that original Blu-ray, crap.
Was the Blu-ray bad?
It was
a rough transfer.
Okay, well, that's different.
And I'm not even as picky as Zach is. And
no, that's different. If the transfer was bad, that's one thing. Yeah. I mean, like, if you had a top-of-the-line, high-quality, Masters is going to get Blu-ray, we're making a 4K version of that.
Sometimes you're right. It doesn't make a big difference.
Yeah, yeah. I get what you're saying.
But yeah, in that case, if it was a bad transfer.
It was a bad transfer.
Yeah, then do exactly swap out the disc.
That's exactly what I'm going to have to do, because I love that steelbook. It's cool.
All right,
comic books. First, some new cool stuff.
We do. For Marvel, we have all-new X-Factor 16, Amazing Spider-Man number 9, which is, again, the start of Spider-Verse proper, Avengers and X-Men Access number 4, Men of Wrath by Jason Aaron number 2, and Rocket Raccoon number 5. There's either a portion or the entirety of this Rocket Raccoon told entirely in I Am Groot.
Oh.
It's apparently Groot is telling a story, and all the dialogue everyone says in the thing is I Am Groot. All the text on the buildings and in the background is I Am Groot. All these sound effects are I Am Groot.
You do know there's a Facebook app out there right now where you can put it on and it makes everything I Am Groot.
I think that would be better.
That's the new Lorem Ipsum.
Yeah.
I Am Groot.
I think that's, yeah.
that's pretty great.
From DC, we have Aquaman and the Others number 7, Batman Essentials, Batman Year 1 Special Edition number 1, Gotham Academy number 2, Grayson number 4, and Justice League 3000 number 11. And on smaller press, we have Angel and Faith season 10, Tooth and Claw number 1, Usagi Yojimbo Senso number 4, and The Woods number 7.
Alright.
There's actually a couple of book books.
Book books?
I'd like to mention.
There's a book book?
Book books, yeah. The last week, the new Peter Hamilton came out, the Abyss Beyond the Dreams,
mm-hmm.
or The Abyss Beyond Dreams. It's part of his Commonwealth series. It's an extension of the Void trilogy, if you've read them.
I know all of these.
It's a good jumping in point if you've not read some of the others.
See, sometimes the names are a mistake because I'm interested in a new sci-fi series, but when I hear it called the Commonwealth series, just not interested.
Well, actually, it's pretty. It's a pretty interesting. It's not as good as maybe the Ian Banks Culture series, but starts out. It's kind of got a steampunky factor. It starts out.
Well, you hate that.
Yeah, I do. But it works in this instance. These two college grad students, develop wormholes.
Yeah.
And basically, wormholes become the basically we colonize the galaxy with wormholes. But instead of like the wormholes can actually be on land, they don't have to be somewhere out floating out in space. So instead of like flying ships or just walking through these wormholes, they set up train lines. So you take a train everywhere in the galaxy. You don't get on a spaceship and go somewhere. You just get on a train and it takes you to Alpha Centauri or whatever.
Ah, that's kind of cool.
That's actually kind of cool.
And it really kind of expands it. Like, you know, you end up even having like wormholes in a house. So you could have like you'd have a wormhole instead of having a door into another room. It'd be a wormhole to take you to a room in a house on another planet.
Go ahead, Zach.
What?
Nothing.
But it's
I'm waiting for the portal reference.
I was actually going to go Interstellar reference, but that was just me.
But it's interesting when the whole thing breaks down.
I'll kill you, Zach. I'll kill you.
Same point. Okay. That's the whole he's had a kind of the void. There's a void trilogy that preceded this. There was a whole story that takes place in a place called the Void, where this area of the universe where the rules don't work the way they do in ours. Physics is different. People have telepathy and real telekinesis. It's space opera. It's an interesting blend.
It's space opera.
But it's more space opera.
Yeah, okay.
The And that's, like I said, it's a good jumping in point. If you want. The other one is Jack McDevitt's new one, the new Alex Benedict novel, which is amazing. Now, it's maybe not a good jumping in point. It's almost kind of wrapping things up, maybe.
Yeah.
But I would wholeheartedly recommend any of the Alex Benedict novels at any point. They're just fantastic.
Are they space opera also?
They are space opera, but it's less of the opera, maybe.
More on the
it's
space.
More spacey. Okay. The Alex Benedict is an archaeologist, and this is set for like thousands of years in the future. And there's been dark ages and comebacks, and you know Earth is still around. Matter of fact, this one they come back to Earth, to try to find artifacts from like the Apollo landing, and some of the early space exploration artifacts. But it's just a really he's going around all over the galaxy trying to collect antiquities to sell, which pisses off a lot of people because they think they should go in museums, and they're still upset with him because he's trying to sell them.
It belongs in a museum.
Yeah. And there's it's a longer series. There's a lot of side characters and stuff. You could jump in with this one. The Coming Home is the name of this one, but I would probably, if you're going to get into it, just go back and buy it. Get the first one and kind of read through.
How many books are there?
I think this is the ninth now.
Holy crap! That's intimidating. That's intimidating.
But they're serial in a sense, but it's not like one of those things where you have to know every little plot point to get to carry on. So you can kind of jump around between them a little bit.
I kind of wanted to pick up something. You know, I haven't read anything book wise without pictures in a while. But there's a lot for me to catch up on because I would need to catch up this new Marvel
Axis.
Yeah,
I'm kind of on Axis aside from the one that came out today.
And did you see the teaser picture that Marvel put out with Spider-Man, Peter Parker?
I was gonna
Spider-Man.
Say every single damn teaser that they released.
I remember. Go ahead.
So Marvel's
just watching for Dwayne. Make sure.
Marvel's been releasing for the past few weeks teasers about events that are happening in summer 2015. Because they had announced first that they're gonna make a new Secret Wars in 2015. Mm-hmm. Then after that, we got like a new Age of Apocalypse in 2015 and a new the one you referenced, Spider-Man and Mary Jane with a daughter getting back together and married again. Renew Your Vows or something it was
something
called.
Like that. I don't care as long as they get it back to proper.
But they had that, and they had, but like I said, a new Age of Apocalypse, a new House of M, a new Civil War, a new all sorts of things, and it's like coming summer 2015.
Yeah,
I have no
so
idea
much.
What it is. But that's the point. The latest one was Everything Ends. And it's just like a white page that fades to black at the bottom and coming 2015. I love the last one before that was X-Men 92 coming summer 2015. And it was the animated series X-Men. it was the one from the 90s, so everyone's wearing the same outfits. And like,
that's awesome.
Yeah, that one I would read.
I'll read that too.
Don't know what they're doing, but it's worked. I'm teased. I want to know what it is.
Very teased as well.
So I am looking forward to that.
All right, cool. There's a lot
to talk about there.
So Saturday night, you can find us, if you are in Tennessee, you can find us at the Wild Wing Cafe doing the Ghost Pepper Challenge. No, it's Sunday. We're going to do
Sunday.
Sunday before Walking Dead. Yes, because they show Walking Dead there live on Sunday nights. Mm-hmm. So you can come watch me and Dwayne, who's downstairs with his car keys locked in his car, and Nathan suffering the Ghost Pepper sauce. And
the rest of us looking on and laughing.
Probably. That's probably the plan, yeah.
And applying first aid.
It's true.
No.
No?
No, well, then it would end the ability to laugh if you apply the first aid. So, Nico, if we were to find you on the internet, where would we do that?
Follow me on twitter.com/NicoScream and Tumblr.
I set up a Tumblr.
Yep.
Yeah.
I like Tumblr. Tumblr has a lot of comic people on it. So comic writers and artists will post a lot of stuff.
It seems like a good way to post art.
It is. It's definitely a very image-meaning site.
Yeah.
But I also like it because I like Brian Michael Bendis and Matt Fraction and Kelly Zutikon. A lot of comic people post on there, so that's one of the main reasons I'm on there.
Cool. Michael Boy?
Just CultureSmash.tv.
Thank you.
And Google+, under Clovis Chitwood, and Facebook, of course, under Mike Young.
All right. You can find me under all the Culture Smash stuff. Facebook, Culture Smash, TV is actually the site. You can find us under Culture Smash on YouTube, Google Plus. Friend us on Google Plus under Culture Smash. Or I guess it's add us to your circle. We'll add you back. Then you can get invited to this exciting live video hangout situation here.
Zach, what about you?
Yeah.
You can find me on Instagram, Master of the Matrix 91. You can find me on Steam, A Dangerous Meat Lunatic. You can also find me on YouTube, Space Mountain Air 91, and you can find me on Snapchat as Psychonaut 91.
So I downloaded this Snapchat business. What is that?
You can send a friend a picture like, hey, look what I'm doing, or hey, what's this, or look at my dick. and it's only there for like 10 seconds max.
Yeah, it said something like you could save things that you make or something, though.
I could see like a horror movie based on that.
Wasn't there one based
like
on the
Snapchat
roulette?
Send clues to get your kidnapped wife or something like that?
I have a lot of friends that really like Snapchat. And basically, it's just you'll be around a group of friends or somebody, and they're doing something stupid, and you take a quick photo of it and send it to everyone else so they can see it, but it disappears right after that.
It's interesting. Part of my day gig is to keep up on the social networking stuff, so I downloaded it, and I'm like, what the hell do I do with this now? So
I'll make some interesting guerrilla marketing.
Yeah, now, yeah, it's like, you know, I don't really want to show a picture of a dick.
I don't use Snapchat, but I do think it's interesting in a couple of aspects. Like, for one, it's the whole point is the picture disappears.
Yeah.
You can download the picture. You can screenshot it, and it notifies the person who sent it.
Really?
So if you try to save the image outside of having another camera device taking a picture of the screen, the person who took it gets a notification. They know that you saved it. Now, I mean, they might not care, but it may be something like if you did send a dick pic and you don't want that getting out, it's like, wait a moment. I'm not sending you any more dick pics.
And they're like, well, what am I supposed to do? I wanted to save the dick pic. Why would you send it on Snapchat?
Tell them they have to come to the source.
Exactly. You have to see it in person. Exactly.
All right.
So it's like a tease. You know, here's what you're going to get, baby. Dick pic. And come on over.
Coming summer 2015?
That's right.
Oh.
What do you think about it, Dwayne?
Oh, yeah, Dwayne.
Where can we find you, Dwayne?
There's Ada.
You can find me on Twitter at DRWorm75.
Fly, blah, blah, blah. All right, that's enough of this mess. We'll see you guys next week.
Bye.
Bye. And I'll do Dwayne. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.
I wish Catherine was here because she could do a great Dwayne.
She does like the perfect Dwayne.
Yeah.
That was awesome. Let me turn this volume up so I can say
some of these people. Quick episode.
It was pretty quick.
It was like less than an hour. Over an hour.
Are we
What's up,
the,
y'all?
No. Hi.
It wasn't less than. It was an hour and 6 minutes. That was actually the perfect length show.
That was. That was cool.
We never do that, though. We're always at hour 20, something like that.
Well, now we know the reason.
Now I know why Hector got Snapchat. I learned. What's that?
What?
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 The bleep.
Who was that? That was you. Yeah, I don't know what the bleep is. All right, y'all. I'm going to hang this up so I can edit.
Bye.
Bye, y'all.
Bye-bye. Bye. 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 Bye.